Good morning, students. We will continue with autotrophic mode of nutrition. Okay, let's see autotrophic mode of nutrition in plants. So let's see what are the requirements for autotrophic mode of nutrition which takes place in plants. What is the simple name given to the process of preparing food in plants? That is, yes, synthesis of food in plants. You all know that is photosynthesis. Photosynthesis, that is preparation of food, synthesis of food in the presence of light. Okay, preparation of food in the presence of light. Green plants. Why again and again we are using the term green plants? Because we all know that there are some plants which are non-green, which do not contain the pigment chlorophyll. So they will not be able to perform the process of photosynthesis. Because what are the requirements for photosynthesis? Let's see. For performing autotrophic nutrition in plants, what are the requirements? So we will write requirements of photosynthesis. First requirement is they need a pigment. Plants, they have a pigment called chlorophyll. Chlorophyll is the pigment which is present in the a green color pigment which is present in the leaves specifically, or green part of the plant. If it is young stem, you can see in them also. So any part which is green in color in the plants, that contain a pigment called chlorophyll. Okay, in which organelle this chlorophyll is present? It is present in chloroplast. And in which organ do we see? This is organelle. In which organ do we see? We see maximum in the leaves. In young stem or any green part of the plant will contain chlorophyll pigment. So the first requirement is the chlorophyll pigment. Second, a source of energy. Basically, in the case of plants, natural source of energy that's acting is sunlight. Sunlight is necessary. It can also work with artificial source of light. Why again and again I'm saying it? Because this chlorophyll molecule, okay, this is a chemical molecule, they absorb solar radiation. Okay, certain wavelength of radiation they are going to absorb. If we are able to provide those wavelength of radiations of light by any artificial source, then also chlorophyll will get activated and they will start working. They will start absorbing. So, natural source sunlight works very well, or white light, which will be able to provide the particular wavelength of radiations. If they are able to provide, then chlorophyll will get activated and will start functioning, will start absorbing the solar radiations. Next is a specific gas which is necessary, which is present in the atmosphere. That is carbon dioxide, CO2. CO2 is present in the atmosphere, carbon dioxide gas, which is necessary for preparation of food in plants. And the most important, water and minerals. Now, how do these plants, they get water and minerals and carbon dioxide? So, carbon dioxide is basically present in atmosphere. Okay? It is taken up by which part of the plant? Which part of the plant will help in taking in of carbon dioxide. Yes, you all know that is again leaves. Okay, leaves contain a special opening or pore called stomata. So through stomata, through this opening, carbon dioxide gas will enter inside the plant's body, inside the leaf. Fine. How do plants get this water and minerals? When we are talking about structure of plant, okay, various parts of the plants, branches are there, then leaves are there, stem is there, okay, then specific tissues are there, vascular tissues are there in the plants, roots, okay. So water and minerals, they will be taken up by the roots, they will be absorbed by roots. From where they are getting this water and mineral? They are getting it from the soil. In the soil, water and minerals are present in dissolved form. Okay, so roots of the plants, they will take it up. They will absorb. By which method? Roots absorb this by the method of osmosis. You will see in detail what is this osmosis. Okay, so roots are going to take up water and minerals and dissolve from the soil by which process? Known as osmosis. Carbon dioxide is taken up by the stomata, which are present in the under surface of the leaf, lower surface of the leaf, lower epidermis of the leaf, okay, small pores are present, that is stomata, and by which process again? You have to write diffusion, by the process of diffusion. These are very important terms, children, you have to remember these terms, okay, which by which process plants take up water and minerals? By the process of osmosis. By which process plants take up carbon dioxide? They take the gases. Exchange of gases takes place by the process of diffusion. Clear to all of you? Let's study the how this plants, they take up, the leaves of the plants, they take up carbon dioxide in detail. We all know that leaves are known as food factory. Why we call it as food factory? Because in the leaves, preparation of food by the process of photosynthesis takes place. By the process of photosynthesis, okay, leaves will prepare food in the plants. You all see the maximum part of the plant, which is green in color, is leaves. Means they contain that green pigment, chlorophyll is present. Now let's see how do these leaves, they take in carbon dioxide. I told you for that we will study the tissues which are present in the leaves. Okay, we will see the outer layer, that is epidermis. Above the epidermis will be a thin layer of cuticle. This is epidermis. Epidermis is the outermost layer present in the leaves. So this is upper epidermis. You can write here upper epidermis. After this epidermis, you will see some cylindrical long rectangular cells. Okay, these are, yes, these are palisade parenchyma. These are parenchyma cells. We have read about parenchyma in our 9th class. Okay, parenchyma cells are thin walled. So we can have one or two layers of this parenchyma, which are long and elongated. Okay, they are arranged in lengthwise. That we call it as palisade. This arrangement is known as palisade. Okay, and we can see this is the arrangement of chloroplasts. There are numerous chloroplasts present in these cells. To accommodate more number of chloroplasts, the arrangement is like this. Okay, in a lengthwise arrangement of the cells, which we call it as palisade parenchyma. What is the reason? Reason is to accommodate more number of chloroplasts for absorbing more amount of sunlight. After this comes your spongy parenchyma, which is in continuation with the lower epidermis. These are the lower epidermis cells, and again lower epidermis also will be covered by this. This is lower epidermis covered by again cuticle. A thin layer of cuticle will be there, and these are spongy parenchyma. Spongy parenchyma has less number of chloroplasts. Okay, they have less number of chloroplasts. They are also parenchyma cells. We all know what are parenchyma cells, which are thin walled. Okay, large vacuoles, thin walled structures. Spongy parenchyma. Together they are known as, both this layer is known as mesophyll layer. This layer is known as mesophyll layer. Upper epidermis, mesophyll, lower epidermis. Okay. If you will see this lower epidermis very clearly, you will see some curved bean shaped cells. What are these bean shaped cells? I will draw the diagram there also. These are stomata. Stomata are guarded by guard cells, and the opening is known as stoma. Opening is known as stoma. You will see between the spongy parenchyma, where the name is given spongy. Sponge means which will have air present in it. So these are the cells which have air cavities. Okay, these are air cavities. Air cavities are the places where air will enter and then it will diffuse into the cells. So exchange of gases will take place basically through these air spaces and the opening of the stomata. This is stomata. This is a general structure of leaf. In between this, even you will find the vascular bundles. Vascular bundles will have, they are the veins. Okay, they will have both type of cells, xylem and phloem. The vascular tissue which provide nourishment, which help in supply of water and minerals and food. Xylem will supply water and minerals, and phloem will supply food. So leaf is getting water through this vascular bundle, xylem. Veins in the leaf, veins are present. Through those veins, the supply of materials take place. Okay, so this is about the structure of leaf. It is given a cross section of leaf in your book. Okay, it's the first diagram which is given. So if you will take a cross section of the leaf, you will get this type of structure. Okay, now how this carbon dioxide enters? Let's see if you all have done. I have to raise this. Okay. So this was the structure of the leaf. We all know now in which layer we will find stomata. We will find stomata. Yes, very often in most of the plant it is in the lower epidermis, but in hydrophytes it is available in the upper epidermis, because lower epidermis is in contact with the water, where they will not be able to do the process of diffusion. So they have in the upper epidermis. Okay, rest most of the plants will have in lower epidermis. Now let's see the structure of stomata. Stomata, they contain two guard cells, okay, and nearby this there will be other epidermal cells called okay, these are known as subsidiary cells. Every stomata has two guard cells. They are beam shaped in dicot plants, and they are dumbbell shaped in monocot plants. Shapes are different, but their function is same. Okay, each stomata is having the two guard cells, and guard cells are having one nucleus. They also can have chloroplast for supporting or for performing photosynthesis. They are supported by the subsidiary epidermal cells. The opening which is present between the two guard cells is known as stoma. This is the structure of stomata. What are stomata? Stomata are present. These are the small pores or openings which are present more often in the lower epidermis of the plants, through which exchange of gases takes place. Okay, so we are on the topic, how do plants get carbon dioxide from the atmosphere? So they will get it through the atmosphere, through the small opening which is present in between the guard cells. There are numerous of guard cells, stomatas in the lower surface. Okay, there are more than 5 lakhs of stomatas in lower epidermis. Okay, now how do this guard cells, they are controlled? Okay, how do they open and close? Okay, generally it is seen that guard cells, they open, or means stomata, they open during the daytime, and at night time they close, means they are functional during the daytime for most of the plants. In desert plants, guard cells, they open, stomatas, they open at night time, and at daytime they do not open. Why? Because they need to, yes, through stomata, again one more process called transpiration takes place, through which water will also, exchange of water, means throwing out of water will take place. To stop this process for water conservation in desert plants, they need to stop that water to move out, because they are not getting enough amount of water. Now, if they are losing water, then also it will be difficult for them to get that water. For conserving water, this is an adaptation they have done, that during daytime, they will close their stomatas, and at night time, they will open it for some time, so that transpiration process is very less, and they will take carbon dioxide, store it in some other form of acid. Okay, and daytime they will keep it closed, but already they have fixed the carbon dioxide and they can utilize it at daytime. But in general, normal cases, okay, C3 plants, it will be taken up during the daytime only, okay, and it will move inside. Now, how do these guard cells open and close? So, very general process takes place in guard cells. When guard cells, they take up water. They take water. Guard cells, there is entry of water in the guard cells. Guard cells will swell up. Okay. When these guard cells swell up, they open the stoma. The stoma opens. So you can write stoma opens and the exchange of gases will take place. Okay. When guard cells lose water, when guard cells they lose water, they will shrink. Okay, guard cells they are losing their water, so they will become what? Flaccid. When guard cells gain water, they become turgid. Okay, so this swell up is turgid, and shrinking is, okay, they are losing water, shrinking is flaccid. The stoma will close. Stoma closes. One more time, let's see how stomata opens. Stomata has two guard cells. Okay. These guard cells, they have a small opening in between. When this guard cell is going to open, okay, when water will enter in the guard cells will swell up, they become turgid, and there will be opening through which exchange of gases will take place. When guard cells lose water, they shrink, they come closer, okay, they become flaccid, and they the stoma closes. So it will stop the process of exchange of gases. Thank you, children.